Please welcome on stage Ben van't Ende.
Good morning. Thank you very much. So I have to recover myself. So thanks for being at my talk, Recovery Methods to Get Things Back on Track. I have to recover myself because it was really a hassle to get everything going. I've got a special setup, it seems. So I want to start in a practical manner where we will go over a few things that will hopefully benefit you in your project. But first off, I want to start with a few physical and practical exercises. I would like you just to get up for a minute or two, also good for recovering from yesterday evening. So please stand up. And I've got this clothes hanger here. So what I hope is that you get a few very small pointers that can help you throughout the day. So the clothes hanger means to relax with your shoulders. So just stand up with your spine and imagine your head is like the curly thing on top and goes up, and your shoulders just hang down like this. Just imagine that. This is really cool. You can do this everywhere without anybody seeing it. So everybody sees it now, but when you're at the office, you can do this just these things, or when you go walking. For me personally, when I just go walk with the dogs and do like this, just relax, breathe out, and just let your shoulders hang like this. And make sure your head is like a clothes hanger and it goes up like this. So one more time, breathe out. Just imagine one more time. This is an exercise that you can really use all during the day. So let's go to another one. Oh, luckily my remote works. This is a very cool exercise that you can use also everywhere, in the train, in the plane, just where you're sitting. Maybe later on in this talk when you just had enough of it and you think, oh, I just really need to breathe. So just follow me. Just a second, and so hold your breath and then breathe out for 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, and hold it. And then breathe in. 2, 3, 4, and hold it. So we do two more cycles. Breathe out. 2, 1, 0, and hold it. And then breathe in. And hold it for like 4 seconds. And for the last one, breathe out. And hold it. Breathe in. And hold it. And you're all done. So now let your shoulders just relax. Just breathe out all the air. Just like this. One more time. Let everything go and cool. You may be seated. So things like this is really beneficial, you know, when you're in the working environment and when you are pretty stressed with things. So especially the last exercise, don't do that when you're across your colleague and really think like, oh. But do that at a moment that feels convenient to you. So I've got a true story about a fictional story. So it's July 1979, a very long time, and I guess a lot of you were not even born at that time. With my friend Paul, I took the electric bus, 1979, even at that period, I think the city I live in was one of the few cities that even had an electric bus. So we were on our way to the capital city. It's raining, it's a summer evening, and we're going to the cinema. And we're a little bit late, I'm a little bit stressed. We get out of the bus, really rushing to the cinema, and I say to my friend, oh, it doesn't really matter if we're too late, because we have the advertisements and we have all the trailers, we don't want to see that, we are just there for the movie. So we get into the cinema, the personnel is really a bit irritated that we're that late. And we come into the cinema watching this. So this was, one of the most epic things that ever happened in my life, being late in a movie. Just coming into the old-fashioned cinema through the center lane with Does anybody know what this is?
Tell me.
Yeah, no, it's the rescue ship from the Nostromo, from the Alien. So it's pretty close. And coming into a cinema with a spacecraft like this coming down is really amazing. And when I was just thinking about this, it was really amazing that this is actually a scene that happened 10 years after 1969, July, the first moon landing. For me, this was always this moment was always really meaningful. And just thinking about the whole series, it had a lot to do with toxic environment. So actually, 1979 was the first toxic environment I actually encountered. So everybody knows this this scene where the inquisitive guy looks into the egg and gets a facehugger on his face. So what happens? You know, internally, you really get a toxic environment. And I also thought, you know, when you watch one of the Alien movies again, you'll definitely see this kind of thing. So what happens? The alien is not really the problem, but what is the problem is the artificial person that allows the toxic environment to be there. So the artificial person is the one that opens the airlock or that closes the doors and causes the alien to remain there. So throughout my life, I had a few other things happening, which I think is a toxic environment. I had my divorce in 1999. Everything is perfectly okay now. I've been already married for another 20 years, which is really cool. But in 2009, so a few of those experiences, I had a burnout, almost a full burnout. And that really got me thinking about a number of things. So looking back at the Alien movie, you can really see the stuff that's happened there. One of the mottos the company has, sending this whole spacecraft into space, recovering an alien, is the crew is expendable. And I think in a lot of projects that we do, or that happen, hopefully not in our open source environment, but in a lot of projects, we really go for the end result. And we don't care too much about the people we're working with. So I think what we quickly discuss in this talk are three things. We talk about value. So when discussing, again, the analogy with the Alien movies, we see there's no value for the crew. We will discuss the whole burnout cycle. I don't know if you've seen, I put some of the leaflets on the tables with the stages 1 to 12. We'll discuss that later. And we'll discuss a few recovery methods. So I think from the value perspective, when you look at that, it's very important in any project, whether it's open source or inner source. I do this kind of talks at a lot of different conferences. It's very important that you value the people that you're working with. And even if you're working with open source, I did a similar talk at an inner source conference. And we always think open source is really cool because everybody knows how to collaborate. Still, open source can give a lot of problems we didn't expect before. I think one of the main things we always were very proud of is a thing called meritocracy. You know, the one that does the most has the most rights to be most visible in the project. But that's not always the case because usually what I feel, people that seem to earn most merit or deserve most credits are the ones that are loudest. So I think that's where diversity also comes in. You really need to have a good look. People that are very shy can be the smartest people. So really have a good look at that, how that's working for you. So an open source community values and provides public feedback, both positive and negative, on contributions. Stay positive to contributors, always. I have seen in my experience as community managers that things can go different ways. But speaking about value, appreciating what people do is the most important thing you can. So I think this is something that you really need to keep in mind. Appreciate the person, be critical of the task. It's actually put this in last evening because we discussed this at length. And it's a thing that I really like. I mean, we can have discussions about things, really heavy discussions. And we are very much inclined to take it personally. And one of the things in the conversations that we do, we really need to make sure that we don't take it personally, that we only are sure that we want to solve some kind of task. So make sure we have different opinions, and that's a good thing. Let's try to make that work together. So that's about value. So the whole burnout thing, I got into my burnout, and I see a lot of different talks how to prevent a burnout. And that's actually something that I want to show you, you know, what are the stages of burnout. Maybe you can recognize it and escape it before. But on the other hand, if you do have a burnout, or I wouldn't say if you're working towards it, just go for it. But for me personally, it really showed me what I want and what I do not want. So let's go through a few of the stages. So there's a kind of a classification. It's not mine, I didn't make it. So if you look for it on the internet, you'll find them, stage 1 to 12. The interesting thing is that, so this talk that I'm doing is also kind of evolving what I saw from the last talk that I did. I really saw people discussing with each other, take care of yourself because you're probably at stage 5 or something. So the first stage would be, the first stage is you kind of recognize everybody goes through that. So demonstrating worth obsessively tends to hit the best employees. So we're all the best employees. Those with enthusiasm who accept the responsibility readily. So you know this, you really want to achieve the best things for your team. The second is working harder. Now who doesn't know that? I think everybody can really say I'm at stage 2. An inability to switch off, we sometimes have this, of course, working until maybe 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. Then stage 3 would be neglecting needs, erratic sleeping, eating disrupted, lack of social interaction. Stage 4 would be displacement of conflicts, demonstrating worth obsessively, tends to hit the best employees. So revision of values, we're getting into the rabbit hole a little more. Values are skewed, you look at things in a different way, and you don't care about your family anymore, you're obsessively engaged with your work. So the sixth one is denial of emerging problems. I think this is also a pretty common thing and a very human aspect. So intolerance, cynicism, aggression, you might have seen all these kind of things in your work environment. So withdrawal, which is in itself a good thing if you really if you intentionally do that. I actually didn't attend the party last night because I really needed some time for myself. So withdrawal in itself is okay, but in the context of burnout, it's not a good thing. And then withdrawal would probably mean that you're not in social life for weeks. Odd behavioral changes. Changes in behavior, obvious friends and family are really concerned. Depersonalization, seeing neither self nor others as valuable. We're getting to the end. So inner emptiness, feeling empty inside, and to overcome this, look for activities such as overeating, sex, alcohol, or drugs. Activities are often exaggerated. So depression, feeling lost and unsure. You'd be surprised if I talk about this topic. There's so many people that have to deal with this, with the depression. And then in the end, there's a burnout syndrome. I actually talked to someone yesterday, he said he was at stage 13. But if you really have a burnout syndrome, then you really need to see the doctor or get to the hospital. So this might be a depressing message, but there's a lot that you can do. So for instance, I would also say if one of your friends kind of suffers with depression or is in the burnout syndrome, don't hesitate to talk about that. Don't really go into the matter itself, but be friendly with people. Just be friends and try to discuss their personal problems. So you'll find some of the flyers outside. And if you want, you can just discuss that with me later. So the good thing is that everything bad that happens in your life or in your project, there is a way to recover from that. And what we try to do, what I try to show you, is that from every bad thing, we can learn something. So not only creating a better workspace, but being part of a wider global corporation, that's eminent, this motivation already to search for your inner self. Just a second. I have the wrong notes here, I think. It's not such a problem. Okay. One of the things is what I saw is that humans can be exceptionally creative in both positive and negative ways. Several motivations propel human ingenuity forward to equally hold us back. So let's look at what possible reasons there could be making your project lose traction and what we can do to get things back on track. So one of the interesting things, one of the talks that I really liked seeing a couple of years ago was the assholes are destroying your project. So I've seen that a number of times. And I think this is this is one of the things that you also should recognize. I mean, there's a lot of things that we can do in our projects to work together in a better way. But there are these people, you know, that you really can't do anything about. And you really need to get them out of your project. There's a really cool book called The No Asshole Rule by Robert Sutton. It's a very small book, but it's very enlightening. And what I thought is very enlightening is that when you used to call somebody an asshole, it was just a swear word. But these days, it's really qualified as a number of properties for a toxic person. So recovery methods. Just one second. Sorry, the internet is a bit slower here. Okay, so we got a number of recovery methods. I think the first one that I'd like to discuss is community. I think in this place, I really found and feel that everybody's got community together pretty well. I've got a very good feeling of collaboration here. So one of the things is a community should always be an essential part of your effort. So in this case, the community feels really good. And I think, you know, lots of the efforts that you do in building your team or building your software, always think of your community. So building a community is essential for the success of any project. So introducing collaboration to the workflow of a company will probably revolve more around code than culture at first. So really think about what it also culturally means. So, you know, working on your project, of course, is very important, but also working on the happiness in your team is maybe even more essential than getting out this awesome project. And this is something, you know, thinking on the long term. So the short-term goals might be, you know, okay, we got this great product out, but if you want to survive as a project, think about the social aspects a lot. So while coding is something the project was already used to, the cultural change to collaboration and community building is something that needs to grow on an organization and needs to be nurtured without having a specific focus on software development. So think about specifically assigning a community manager or somebody that's really focused on community. You don't specifically need to call it a community manager, call it whatever you want. So keeping the big picture on the social collaboration aspects of your undertaking, your endeavor, your project, whatever. A central person that motivates people and communicates about progress is a big plus in any collaborative effort. Now, I think the next one is one of the things that's most important, and we already kind of discussed earlier. Things will go wrong in your project, always. But in itself, that is also an opportunity to take your project further and even make it a lot better. So that things will go wrong down the line is a universal truth. So use adversity as both a learning experience and an opportunity. So when things go wrong in your project, your expertise, your personal integrity might be at bay. So actually, it's not so much the humans we need to be tough on, it's the task that needs our undivided attention. So we set out with certain goals we truly believe in. Now it's time to take a step back and analyze what causes the negative experience. I think this move, you know, taking the step back, taking a pause, is essential throughout your whole project. Whatever you're doing, you're working on documentation, you're working on programming, you're working on whatever, always try to take a breather like we exercised in the beginning and think about what you're actually doing. So think about the factors that brought you in this situation. What could you control? What couldn't you control? Be careful not to overanalyze every small thing. So keep the big picture in mind. So as a next step, trust in the fact that you learned something that energizes you and encourages you to get the project back on track. You have learned something that made you more resilient, enabling you to lead the project in a more energized way. I think this is the lesson. So the resilience, stuff will go wrong in your life, in your project, and you will learn a lot. And if you take a good look at it, you will be more resilient. You will be able next time to overcome problems a lot better. So stay positive and learn from your mistakes. So I have gone through that journey and I learned that all change comes from within. So instead of seeing it as a rough and tough time, I learned to see it as a period where I've learned to become the real me. So another aspect we can take into account for getting back on track or staying on track is to design for success. So a successful implementation does not so much depend on what needs to be achieved, but equally who is involved in the project. So focusing on the material aspects only is designing for failure. This is also about community management, of course. So take the human aspect into the equation. The challenge in designing for success lies in bringing users and technology together in a human-centric way. I think this is always a large challenge. We work with technology a lot, but we're also working with humans.
Sorry.
So the tendency is to jump right into solution thinking and overlooking who the members of the team are and what problems we are actually trying to solve. So one thing to add here is that very much about the thing and not about the person, right? So also one very important aspect, they are all very important, is to take small steps. So with the end goal of a project in mind, or whatever we have on the horizon, we are inclined to accelerate rather than carefully look at our current achievements. So it's this acceleration that leads to failure. Remember, collaboration and open source is a journey. It's a journey that we do together, especially see this here. We're really in it together. So focus on what you can work with. So success comes from taking small steps and smart steps. In the spirit of agile methodologies, take the first step as quickly as possible. So look at what you have at hand and work with that. Also look at what that step might cost you if things might not work out. This allows you to gain traction and get others back on track. Listen to yourself, that's very important. Take a breather, listen to yourself, and inspect and adapt with every step. I think this is the kind of the inspect and adapt method or motto is something that you can use like everywhere. I think for myself, I used to be more like the guy that really needed to think about everything, and it could take days for me to get something together. And these days I'm more like the small steps, just go for it and see where things end up. So now we have freed ourselves from traditional cascading project methodologies. There are countless opportunities to learn at every step of the way. One other thing is, so we talk about, you think, oh, this is all very fluffy, and we can talk about breathing and about spiritual things, but at the same time, we also need to be accountable for the stuff that we do. So all too often we find ourselves over-enthusiastic and promising things that we cannot deliver. So we excuse ourselves being busy, if we excuse ourselves at all. So from my past experience in managing projects and communities, I found people even being insulted when reminding them of a promise. I mean, it's like, can't you see I'm very busy? And that's just the way it is. Looking at what we previously talked about, it's easier to show a small step than it is to take a jump. Definitely. Sometimes it's pretty dangerous to take a jump. So maybe it's not even the individual promise you missed, but being in the mindset of not caring is the cumulative impact that will not let you get back on track. So a few small suggestions. You have no time for a 1 hour meeting. Do a 10-minute stand-up. No time to write a blog post, write a paragraph. No time to take the afternoon off, take half an hour off and go outside, leaving your mobile at your desk. I talk to a lot of people, you know, that really say, oh, I can't do this, I can't do that because I'm too busy. Just make it smaller steps. Don't take half a day off, just half an hour, maybe even 10 minutes, but do it fully conscious. Stick to your schedule even in small ways. Now, another interesting one is, say no. Say no, 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 no. No, 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 not today. So collaboration can be really demanding. So we're in it for the community, and as the hierarchy fades away, there are more individuals and teams that are on the same level playing field. So your expertise and skills are in high demand. Everyone wants the piece of you. You want to say yes, but to remain in control and deliver quality, it might be time to say no. So if you get another request, just step back, take a breath, and think about how this fits in your workload. What are the benefits? Now, you don't have to be blunt with a straight out no, but you can also think about offering an alternative or schedule the request for a later date. If you say no, say it in person and through any other visual communication. Saying no in an email can be experienced as rather rude, so don't do that. Do that in a personal way. One other thing that's really important is to care. So actually, my intention was to do a talk on the art of making people care, but I just didn't have time to prepare that, but it's still an interesting topic that I'll definitely do at a later stage. But I've got a small paragraph about it instead of a big talk. So where things can go really wrong is when people find themselves in the position where they do not care anymore. I've seen this happen quite a lot of times. So this will quickly destroy your project. Get into a project in a genuine matter is very vital. So we are dealing with a management method. We are not dealing with a management method anymore. So where we put financial returns at the forefront, even though they are, of course, an essential part of why your community is in the game, collaboration, people, and communication are in the center, are in the spotlight. So connect to people in your team or project and communicate in a mindful way. In a mindful way just means think about it, take a step back. What does it bring to you? What does it bring to the other person? So engage with awareness and really listen to what your team members have to say. I think it's really underestimated what listening can bring to your project. I mean, it's really cool if you're a smart guy or a smart person and can talk for hours and hours, but I think it's even more powerful if you're able to listen. You will see them light up. So if I listen to you, you will really be happy, really listening, truly listening. So bring out the best of yourself to bring out the best of someone else. So now we have to move forward. So we discussed a number of methods here that can help you get your project back on track. While each and every method covers a specific topic, all have a few things in common that I would like to relate to as your true inner open source. Be mindful of what goes on around you in the project. So take a pause, like I said earlier, take a step back before you are forced to take a step back. So take things in your own hand. Be genuine and authentic in the way you act. This will keep your project moving forward. So this is about it, what I had to say. And I used to have a really smart quote from Confucius here, but I just give you my puppy because that will give you a good start of the day. Thank you very much.